I will welcome everyone to the meeting of the Environmental Review Implementation Subcommittee, or ERIS, for June 12th, 2024. I'm Sarah Stroman. I'm the Commissioner at the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources and the Chair of ERIS. I think we'll just begin, unless Kevin, you have any meeting announcements, we'll just begin with the roll call.
All right. Thank you, Chair. I think we're expecting seven of our ERIS members today. Commissioner Arnold?
I'm here. Yep. Okay. It just took me a minute to get off mute. I do have to pop away for a little while and then we'll be back.
Okay. All right. Board Member Bauer Kemper? Was not expecting him, but I wanted to check. Commissioner Dobenberger, here.
You are here.
Board Member Hintz?
Here.
Chair Pullman?
I am here.
Commissioner Kessler?
I am here.
Board Member Nelson?
Here.
Commissioner Stroman?
I am here.
All right. So that is seven. So we have a quorum. I'm going to call, do we have any other board members who are not ERIS members joining us today? I see Board Member Katzenberger here. Anyone else? Any EQB board members who are not ERIS members joining us, just so we know you're here? Good.
Great. All right. With the roll taken. Next on the agenda is our approval of the consent agenda for today. We have the meeting minutes from the March 20th, 2024 ERIS meeting. That's on page 5 of the packet. And then we have the agenda for today, June 12th, 2024. That's on page 3 of the packet. And I am looking for a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
And I can second that motion.
Okay. Moved by Commissioner Dobenberger, seconded by Commissioner Kessler. Any discussion on the motion to approve the consent agenda? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, please say nay. Hearing no opposition, the motion carries. Consent agenda is adopted. Next on the agenda is the Executive Director's Report, so I will turn it over to Director Neuschler.
All right. Thank you, Chair. Thank you for those of you that are here in person. It's nice to have you here, and I'm looking forward to discussions. We are downstairs in the windowless room, so I'm not quite sure what the weather looks like.
It's not raining at this moment.
It's not raining, but we are in the safe room if a tornado happens. If a tornado warning happens, we may get a lot of friends very quickly. So we'll see. Well, hopefully that won't happen, and we will get through our agenda without any adventures. One thing we did add to the agenda today, I apologize, it's taken me a year of running these meetings to figure out that it would be a good thing to take a brief break during our meetings. So we did program in a 5-minute break about halfway through, and we're going to plan to continue to do that moving forward, just so people have a chance to get up and stretch and maybe go check the windows and see if it's hailing. So just a reminder to everybody who is here, the meeting is being recorded. We do have a meeting chat that is open and visible, but we do not keep that as part of the record. So please just use that for technical issues or logistical issues. The presenters today for your ERIS members, they will welcome your questions and feedback and comment. If you're online, use the raise hand or jump in during discussions. All of our ERIS members and board members should be able to mute and unmute themselves during the conversation. If you are online, if you can put your camera on while speaking, that is always helpful. For members of the public, if you want to make comments on any of the items we've discussed, that will be the last component of our agenda today. I was going to say if you're here in person, but I don't think we have any public members in person. We do have sign-up sheets in the room for anyone that comes in. If you're online, when we get to that part of the meeting, just use the raise hand feature and we will call on you and cue commenters at that point in the agenda. We will notify you when you are able to unmute and speak. Just be patient. There might be a little lag until you can push those buttons to unmute yourself. And if you need a reminder, procedures and guidelines are on page 2 of the packet. And troubleshooting information is linked on page 1 of the packet. So then report and announcements. And I'm realizing we don't have great cameras for this, but we do have 2 new EQB staff with us in the room today. So we have Elizabeth Batsaikon. Elizabeth, do you want to just stand up for a minute? Don't think that I can move the camera fast enough. But Elizabeth is a student worker, so she's joining us through the Increasing Diversity in Environmental Careers program, which is a cooperative program between PCA, DNR, and Bowser that EQB has started participating in. Elizabeth is a rising senior at McAllister, and she's going to be working with us through early August and doing some data projects that are connected to what you're going to hear about more later. And then next is Sarah Larrell. And Sarah is graciously with us today, even though technically she doesn't work here yet. She starts on June 26th. So Sarah is going to be part of the environmental review team, providing technical assistance, both generally and with a specific focus on supporting DEED's Energy Transitions Office and the Energy Transition Communities. She's coming to us from MPCA's landfill operator certification and training program and with some local government experience too. And I apologize, we don't have our fancy spinny camera today, so we couldn't see them if you were online. But they are here and we're very glad to have them. Otherwise, I don't have a lot of announcements. I was going to give just a really brief legislative update. There were a lot of items circling about that we talked about at various meetings that could have potentially impacted EQB and environmental review. There are just 2 that passed that are going to require environmental review rule changes, and I'm going to just go ahead and talk about those when we get to the fiscal 25 work plan part. So that is my update for today, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Executive Director Neuschler. Any questions from ARIS members? Or EQB board members, either folks in the room or online. And if you're online, you can raise your hand or just jump in. All right, seeing no questions, I think we will go ahead and move into the next item on our agenda, which is the first substantive item of business. And it is an update and review of our fiscal year 25 environmental review draft work plan. And Director Neuschler, I think you're going to present this for us.
Thank you. So I think last year we did this in July, but I'm trying to be a little more early this year so we can have this going into our EQB overall work plan. So this is just a preliminary idea and looking for comments, thoughts, questions, suggestions on what we think is on our plate for environmental review. Colleen, click in. Can you click into the slot? Let's see if it works. Here we go. Okay.
I think it's just really delayed.
It's just really delayed. All right. We're having fun with the technology in this room today. This is just a reminder. I think I showed this last year. I like the plates and the buffet analogy, right? Where there are lots of things that we could potentially do. We've had a lot of discussions on our strategic plan, and really that helps direct our focus. And then our work plan is going to define what we pick up, informed by our capacity. That work plan is what of all the buffet of things we could do, what are we going to put on our plate? So for today's meeting, I'm really just looking for some input on the environmental review projects that we have that we think should go on our plates for fiscal 25. Do they have the right focus? Are they meeting the right needs? And are we where do we need to particularly consider our capacity and our partner agency's capacity? And then also just a reminder of the work planning model. We go from the strategic plan to the overall EQB work plan, designating what work we're going to take on, and then the individual work plans that assign them to the staff and project plans to do scope and deliverables for those projects. And we check in through staff meetings and regular check-ins I have with the staff and giving you all updates on how things are going. So for fiscal 25, I have again just done 1 year because it covers the remaining fiscal year of the biennium. I think next year we might think about doing a whole biennium work plan, because sometimes that much doesn't change from year to year, but it chose just to do 1 year so at this point. And so the work plan will identify kind of the program area, the projects, the key timelines. We are working to link it to the strategic plan, goal, and strategy supported based on the draft that we have. We can tweak that as needed based on how the strategic plan goes. It is out for some public input right now. And then agency support needs. Those aren't shown yet on what's in the packet, the support needs in particular, and we do want to consider them, but we know that environmental review in particular always has interagency support needs because we're working with all of our tech reps and environmental review practitioners. And looking at, still thinking about how to designate that this year and maybe do a little bit of high, medium, low degree of help that we think we need, or how much capacity from our partners it may take. So to a reminder of what the strategic plan goal 3 is, which focuses on environmental review, what we've drafted, and so what I've chosen to use, even if we might tweak this in a little bit, is to maintain and improve the review program. And our strategy is really focused on guidance and training and support to local governments, doing tools and guidance to support the inclusion of climate pollution and resiliency information in environmental review, improving data collection so that that can support our ability to evaluate the effectiveness of the program and how we provide technical assistance, and then sort of the development and implement updates to the rules to support program effectiveness and clarity. So that's what's shaping where we have gone. And so I've grouped this here in by the strategy. So supporting RGUs and completing EAWs, what we're looking at for Fiscal 25 is doing some guidance updates, cleaning up and better formatting our existing guidance. Currently, we have two really big, many tens to 100 page PDF documents from, I think, 2010 and 2013. That format's hard to update, it's hard to navigate, and at this point, it's just outdated. I think the staff said, well, you know, it still says you can send us CD-ROMs of information, and I can't read a CD-ROM on my computer. So our first focus is to just make those web-based, just get rid of information that's clearly outdated or inaccurate just because of the age of the information, and do some better formatting so that it's more accessible. And then we know there are some key places where we do want to expand guidance, particularly for our local governments. And the ones that are top of the list and on the work plan right now is to develop guidance for submittal and evaluation of petitions for EAWs, and to develop some best practices and guidance for considering tribal, cultural, and historic resources within the EAW form. And then the last piece, and part of what Sarah is going to be working on, is the AUAR guidance to review the existing guidance that we have and to evaluate the need for updates. Then we want to do some training just to make sure people know what guidance is out there and how to get it and how to use it. And then the last part, and I think this one did not unfortunately end up in the table in your packet, it was just got dropped. Continuing the project of decision criteria, we put this on the work plan last year, and Colleen did some very preliminary evaluation with the state RGUs. But we need to continue to ask and evaluate what the local governments need around decision criteria and see if there is support that is needed there. I think there's not a decision at this point that for sure something needs to change, but we want to evaluate that as we had put on our work plan last year. For strategy 2, supporting the inclusion of climate and environmental review, this is really all continuing work that Steph is leading and Kayla is helping with on the greenhouse gas emission calculator development in progress with our contractor. And then there will be a user manual with that will describe how it's going to work. And then we will work on updating the guidance for how you answer those EAW questions and for both emissions and for climate resiliency, and do some training and roll out of all of those. So this is our big project that we got the funding for in the 2020 legislative session, and it continues through with the calculator scheduled for delivery at the end of fiscal year 25. Training will probably go into fiscal 26. And then the next two chunks of strategy of projects, you will hear much more about shortly for the rest of the meeting. And Jesse's going to be presenting on data. One of our fiscal 24 projects was to update the data management plan, and you have pretty much a final draft updated plan in your packet. And that has led to multiple projects to improve our data collection going forward, to better manage past data, which is part of what Elizabeth's going to be working on, and starting to provide better sharing of data and information about the environmental review program. So really the two new things are this idea of doing some surveys to gather key data about timelines, engagement, and how EQB is doing, and then better sharing our data. And like I said, Jesse will go into great detail about those. And then the last one is to develop and implement updates to the rules, the 4410 rules, and sort of connected program operations. So the mandatory categories report, which was on our fiscal 24 work plan and is continuing because of its due date in December, is a key part of evaluating the needs around 4410. So Kayla is going to talk more about this in a moment. So we're currently reviewing potential recommendations with the co-authors and developing those recommendations for the categories. And I have on the work plan a sort of a placeholder for any of the recommendations that might choose that might we might choose to make to move forward into programmatic changes. And then the next two things are the rulemakings that came out of the legislative session. So the first one is to participate in a technical advisory committee and to consider the need for environmental review mandatory categories for gas and oil production, and particularly in this case, non-hydrocarbon gas. And so DNR is leading this technical advisory committee, and multiple agencies were directed to look at their rules and consider whether changes need to be made. And, you know, if there is going to be a lot of gas production or helium production in Minnesota, I think we probably do need to think about a mandatory category. So that will be one of our projects. The second one is energy infrastructure permitting rulemaking. And this was required by the legislature to align 4410 with the changes that were made to the energy infrastructure permitting process in I'm not going to remember the name of what they called the act, but it was an energy infrastructure permitting bill that went through the process and was rolled into a big omnibus at the end of session. So that both of those are expedited rulemaking, so they allow us to use slightly less process, and so that they're not as big a capacity concern as they might be if it was a full rulemaking process. Still plenty of work to do rulemaking. And then the last one in this category is that we did put on the work plan rerunning the continuous improvement process that we developed in fiscal 23. When the board approved that process in June of 23, this idea of soliciting ideas for program improvements, reviewing the scope, scoring the improvements, and then planning implementation, the idea was it would happen once a biennium. And since the last round kind of finished in June of 2023, we continue with us every other year process that would happen in June of 2025. So that is the quick version of kind of the projects that we have in mind for fiscal 25, just for the environmental review scope of work. Next month or August, I will bring all of it together for the full board, but I am happy to take questions, comments, concerns, direction to do something else instead? What should we do more of? What should we do less of? Happy to take comments at this point.
Excellent. Thank you, Director Neuschler. And let's open it up to questions or comments from IRIS members first, and then I want to open it up to the EQB board members who are here. And it looks like Chair Holman, you have your hand up, so why don't you start?
Thank you, Madam Chair. The only question I had, Catherine, had to do with kind of our last year's Duluth experience in the EQB's role in identifying the regulatory government unit, or the responsible government unit, I should say. If it is in fact locally determined by local units of government, to assign that authority to a planning commission or to a different committee that by ordinance isn't recommending to a city council or a county board, is somewhere in here, and I'm thinking it's under guidance and training, maybe. Is that something that we have to focus on, or is that completely off of EQB desk and onto local government to figure that out on their own?
That's a good question. I mean, I think the way that ultimately played out in the courts, I think the court, I'm not even sure if I did report back. The court did ultimately rule that Duluth had followed its own process. And our rules in general just speak to which local government it is. And, you know, I think we try not to get into that level of detail, just as we wouldn't tell Commissioner Stroman who she can delegate environmental review decisions to within DNR. So I don't really think that would be on our work plan. I think to some extent, the petition process and the fact that to sort of remind local governments, here's what they should do when they get a petition for an EAW and how to work through the process. There might be something there to say, like, when we send you a petition, this is how you should evaluate it. Maybe a few recommendations there. I think it would fit into that process. If we thought we needed to sort of remind them how they needed to respond to petitions.
Madam Chair and Catherine, I don't think I disagree with that at all. What I'm wondering is that it seems like the board has some kind of obligation because we publish the monitor and, you know, we publish the notice where everybody goes. And so it seems like, you know, if that case outcome or that court decision determined that, yeah, you know, here's the regular or the responsible government unit, but, you know, it also really means that the local unit of government, the city or the county, is a responsible party. Do we need to have an asterisk that says dependent on local, you know, government other determinations? That's kind of where I was going with that, is because it seems like as somebody looking into the review process, you budget time and your energy on where you think the decision is going to be made, and then work to develop participation in that realm only to find out later that it could change. So I don't know. I completely agree with what you just said, that it really isn't ours to fix. But it seems like that since we publish what local governments say in the monitor, it appears like we are emphasizing or saying what the process, review process is, but really don't have control or knowing outcome of the public process. So we don't need to dwell on this. I just bring it up as kind of a, I'm not finished thinking about all of that yet. Maybe many of us are not, but it was just an interesting turn. Thank you.
And I'll just say, Director Dussler and Chair Holman, in response to that, there may be something more that we can help the public understand that local units of government are constructed differently depending on which one you're dealing with. And, you know, folks should check. I will say, and I'm biased as a local government, as a former local government official, but I mean, I don't think it is ours at the board to, one, I don't know how we could with so many different units of governments across Minnesota to understand how they are individually structured and where authorities are delegated, that we could take on responsibility for that, nor should we dictate, right? But I think maybe just to be clear to folks, I mean, the city of Duluth is the city of Duluth in this case, right? Whether it is the planning commission, whether it's the city council, whether it is the mayor, whether it is the city manager, how they choose to delegate their authorities really is up to them. And I think we can help the public understand that the city of Duluth may mean multiple things, right? Depending on how that city or whatever the local unit of government is in a certain case has chosen to organize itself as they are allowed to do. So I think maybe it's more of a point to the public to just remind them that when we name a unit of government, that may, the process may look different one to the next. Yes, Commissioner Doppenberger.
Thank you. And on the same theme of our local governmental units, just wanted to mention too, so I appreciated seeing the bullet on there about reaching out to them, understanding where they might need more guidance. And I'm hoping the state agencies can be involved, of course, with developing the guidance as it pertains to their areas of expertise. But what I wanted to mention too is that, so we were just talking about their authority and delegating their authority, but also understanding where they're at with the mandatory categories and understanding what their understanding is of the different mandatory categories, especially climate category, and knowing how to approach that now with our greenhouse gas calculator, the new EAW or the EAW form, and how those two interact. I think more guidance on that, not just for LGUs, but any RGU will be helpful. But when it comes to those mandatory categories, I kind of assume that different local governmental units are at different places with understanding all of those.
Member Nelson.
Madam Chair, thank you. Quick question for the executive director. It occurs to me that in doing the continuous improvement project and the feedback that we got, that we kind of raised expectations of the public or affected parties for implementing many of those items. And there's extensive lists of possible actions or things suggested. And it's been a while since we've had that conversation, and I don't have total recall. So I do recognize within the list of things here, you know, the decision criteria was something that's out of that. But what other things from the continuous improvement project are going to be touched on with this work plan?
Member Nelson, I have just a few slides in anticipation someone might have asked that question. So this was the list that was kind of the top 10, 12 that we went through last year. And so what I did was I italicized the ones that I think we're working on in some way. So the top four about a peer review panel, changing the appeals process, having an ombudsperson, or changing the petition process, not currently on the work plan. The cumulative impacts analysis, I think, it's kind of moved between environmental review and sort of the rest of the rest of the staff work plan. And we did talk about it for the overall draft strategic plan. So I think the plan for fiscal 25 is to stay abreast of what's happening in cumulative impacts, to try to understand and really lay out for internally, sort of how do we understand what's allowed in environmental review under the rules that we have, and then to try to figure out what we can do from there and how environmental review can support the projects that are already going on, like the MPCA's, you know, rulemaking and what it might require for permits and like what other things might be out there that people want. So I think that we will be doing work on cumulative impacts in some way. And I think that's not, I put it in the other part of the work plan. And then continues to develop requirements for evaluation of greenhouse gas emissions and reviews, which we will be are doing with the calculator, and then reconsidering the guidance the calculator goes through. The next chunk, alternatives analyses, alternative types of analyses or different kinds of forms. We're not looking at this point. Life cycle analysis is being considered in that one is not italicized because we're not looking at it separately, but it is being built into the greenhouse gas calculator where appropriate. The decision criteria we're working on, the data management plan and gathering is we're working on strength and capacity to provide technical assistance. that part I think we are doing, but we are not planning to review all documents that are submitted by local governments. And then the guidance and training that really became a big chunk of the work plan. So that was the list that we looked at last year. So I think you're right. I think there are a lot of expectations out there and we've made some progress, but probably not as much as some folks would like.
Can I build on? Thank you, Madam Chair and Executive Director Neuschel. I'm really glad that Board Member Nelson asked this question because this was the question I had. And I appreciate that you have anticipated this question. One of the things that I struggle with when I look at work plans is, we want to be aspirational and set bold vision for ourselves. And then we also need to be realistic about like what we can actually get done. And I think to Board Member Nelson's point, we need to help manage expectations about externally, but what we can actually get done. And I was looking at the continuous improvement bullet and it reminds us that we have asked staff to biannually implement the process of collecting ideas. And I think that's great. But also, if you have half the ideas that we still haven't even gotten to from last time, it might be worth revisiting this with the whole board as to whether or not this is reasonable for ourselves and for others to set false hopes. I mean, it doesn't mean that we won't get new ideas that will rise to the top above some of these, but I think we can't continue to add 15 new ideas every 2 years if we can only truly do like four. So I just put out there that you have a aggressive and bold and I think important charge and work plan, and that if we continue to just ask the universe what else we should be doing, we may not continue to make progress on what we have prioritized we said we should do.
I want to build on this too, but I also just want to note that Commissioner Arnold noted in the chat that she had to depart for the next 30 minutes and then we'll be back. I had the same thought as Member Nelson and Commissioner Kessler. And I think, you know, to me, it's really important when we ask the public to weigh in and, you know, give us specific feedback, that we really do have the capacity to honor that feedback. You know, when people contribute their time, I feel it's important for agencies to be able to reciprocate that investment that we've asked others to give us. And I agree with Commissioner Kessler's suggestion that I think it's something when the full work plan comes to the board of what really what biennial cycle is the right one for that continuous improvement. I mean, I look at the time frame of early 2025, and here we are in the middle of 2024, you know, we're partial progress on half of the ideas that came, you know, that were prioritized, not even the ideas we got, the ideas we prioritized last time. We have the mandatory categories report that is also going to generate some ideas to focus on. And, you know, we have some things that the legislature gave the EQB to do that we didn't anticipate. And so I agree that I think that expectation setting is really important. And this isn't to be negative or critical of the work plan as it's laid out, but I really do think it is important for ourselves to be realistic, but also I really hesitate to go out and ask the public to invest time in thinking about where we could apply time and energy if we don't really have that time and energy. And so to that point, I also think as this the full work plan goes to the board, I think one of the things that would be helpful is to make note of the things that are really required that we do. So, you know, the greenhouse gas calculator, we got legislative funding to do that. The oil, the non-petroleum gas work, you know, that's mandated now by the legislature. And I'm sensitive to that one because that also is an entirely new program at DNR that we've been asked to stand up. And so, you know, I think it's important for the board to be aware of those things that we are legislatively required to do, either by virtue of a mandate or some kind of funding, which also implies a mandate, and things where we might have discretion to prioritize, because that's going to be important as we think about really how much more we can take on beyond what has sort of been given to us by the legislature. any other thoughts from, I'll open it up either to ARIS members or to EQB members.
Just for roll call, did I see board member Martin join us online?
Yes, I'm on.
Okay, great. Thank you.
All right. Well, I think that is our feedback here. So, we'll leave it there. The last thing I will say, we have this the same benefit, I'll just say, and sometimes it's a benefit, sometimes it's maybe a challenge at DNR is, the commitment. And I do want to recognize the commitment of the EQB staff to, want to address all of these issues. I think I would rather be in a position of having, right, an ambitious agenda and having to whittle down than saying, where's the substance? And so I do think it is a reflection of folks' passion and commitment around this. And we definitely want to appreciate that and think it is part of the board's responsibility to help, all of us be realistic and make this a doable work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for the input.
Okay, so we will move on to the next item, which is the presentation on data management. And I'm going to welcome Jesse to give us that presentation. And then I'll just also note we have an attachment in our package.
Situate myself before I get started. Well, good afternoon. Thank you, Chair, and ARIS members and other board members that are present for having me here today. For anybody that's online that is unfamiliar with who I am, my name is Jesse Kuzinski. I'm with the Environment Review Team here with EQB. And today I plan to discuss the revision to the Environment Review Data Management Plan. Before I get started, I did want to give a little bit of context and background about the actual Data Management Plan and its sort of development from its early stages and where we are today. And so it has been around for a number of years. It actually started kind of during the strategic planning efforts of 2018, where some priority results around EQB's ability to support governmental units going through environmental review, and also working to ensure that the environmental review program and process was transparent, accountable, and efficient. And so following those efforts within the strategic planning, the data management plan was developed the following year, 2019, as sort of a way to support and track how well the program was really at achieving those goals. And so since then, since the 2019 first kind of development has been updated a number of times since then. Some of those were just simple formatting changes, but otherwise there has been additions to certain data points and metrics that are collected and data sources that collected those metrics as well. And specifically kind of around the questions that were added to the EQB monitor submittal service to provide greater information about how the program is being implemented and things of that nature. It was a bunch of data. It was my way to make it so interesting, right? It was a bunch of all the files. Way to zhuzh it up a bit. So with that, I'll talk a little bit more about kind of the actual goals within the data management plan as it's defined within the revision. And so the EQB has really is maintaining a data management plan as a tool helping to understand, the program itself and how it is implemented and what it's achieving. And so because the delegation of the authority to implement the rules of environmental review is really spread out across the state to different, responsible government, it really just highlights the need for EQB to really define and track what is happening within the program. And then also given you know, EQB's actual responsibility to publish environmental review notices. It does give that access to the EQB to have that information for project specific information that's going through environmental review. And so the data management plan then sort of recognizes EQB's role in sort of the ideal steward in collecting that information and analyzing that information. And then the plan goes from there and recognizes, you know, EQB's role within environmental review for actually assessing the effectiveness of the program. And from there, the plan then recognizes and identifies information that the EQB can collect to help build that understanding and then grow that into, you know, how to analyze that information to truly understand what is actually happening within the program and to continue to assess the effectiveness of the program. And then the plan also identifies ways that EQB can then share that analysis and that understanding of the program and provide some transparency around what is happening with environmental review. And then lastly, the plan really is meant to provide consistency, not only to, you know, EQB staff and collecting and analyzing that information, but also to program users and providing that consistency and understanding what they should be expecting to provide as far as information within the program to EQB staff. And then so a last point within the data management plan is when you're doing data analysis and collecting information and doing sort of a research sort of idea, it does need to have the ability to adapt and change. I think we've already seen that, given that there's been a number of revisions of the data management plan. Once we start collecting and analyzing information, it may lead to the need to identify new sources or new pieces of information to help better understand. And specifically, this revision does identify some future needs that could benefit the understanding of the program. And so it kind of plays on that idea of it may need to adapt again in the future. So with that, I do want to hit on a couple of highlights that come across through the data management plan revision. And one of the bigger ones that I want to start with is kind of on this idea of how we categorize the information that we're collecting. And so this revision really differentiates itself from past revisions in sort of its intentional way to really delineate the difference between the data that is utilized to represent sort of the operational aspects of the program and data that is used to represent the effectiveness of the program. And so past renditions of the data management plan were really heavily reliant on building that understanding of, you know, what's happening in environmental review and sort of that program operation aspects. When I say program operation, I mean the kind of information that is, you know, like descriptive data and the specific metrics like, you know, who's doing it, who's the RGU, what they're doing, the type of mandatory category, the type of process. So, that information is well collected and defined within our past data management plans. And so we have, you know, a plethora of the information and access to that information to us. And that's great. And this plan, this revision to the plan does continue to recognize the importance of that, given that EQB does need to have that collection of information to truly understand what is going through the program. But then builds on that and begins to sort of identify the need to build a better understanding of how effective the program is and incorporating, you know, information that that informs the EQB how the program is actually being implemented and what the program is truly achieving, and kind of combining those to build a better understanding and being able to assess the actual effectiveness of the program. And then the next highlight that I did want to touch on kind of builds on that idea of the plan identifying, you know, aspects of the program that we haven't necessarily defined well in the past with effectiveness data. And so there are new metrics that are presented in the data management plan. And they build upon that idea of better defining effectiveness data, which is then taken a bit of a step further and expanded into sort of the development of performance measures and sort of indicator data that can help define those performance measures. And so by utilizing you know, the objectives of environmental review, which are written in rule 4410. And then as well as incorporating the understanding of an effective environmental review program, which was developed as a part of the CI process with the creation of the effectiveness matrix. And then by incorporating those, we can then begin to, you know, actually define ways that we can measure and sort of start to identify new metrics and of those effectiveness criteria and actually begin to measure if the program is achieving those ideas. And so within the new plan, within the revision of the plan, there is an identification of new metrics and information that can help inform those ideas. And within the plan, it did identify the need to actually expand and add a new data source in order to collect those new that new information and inform those metrics. And I do want to touch on that a bit more. I think it was a part of Catherine's slides as well regarding the new survey system. So I'll touch more in depth on that in a couple of slides, but as a highlight, I want to point it out. But then the next piece that I really wanted to highlight that comes out of the revision is sort of new opportunities for increased sharing of the data that is currently being collected. The past revisions and the past data management plan really just focused on summarizing all this information, sort of an annual performance report. And that is super useful, but it's kind of the only place that's ever lived and being able to utilize the information in other ways is called out within the plan. And it's another thing that I want to touch on again here in another couple slides in more detail and how how the plan actually identifies how we can do that. And then the plan also identifies the need to really further incorporate the data that we're collecting into other publications that the EQP is in charge of, not just the annual performance report. Like I mentioned, that's really just kind of the heart when it comes to the data that we collect is just sitting within that performance report. So the plan does identify some routes that makes sense to share environmental review data in. And for some specific examples, the mandatory category report that Kayla is working on right now, we have a presentation later, specifically a piece that we called out and we've sort of incorporated into. I'll let her give you that information if it's more, but thinking about how, you know, discretionary EAWs, when they're ordered and how if they compare to a mandatory category, when you look at that information, the, you know, percentage of discretionary orders and how that may coincide with determining the accurateness of those thresholds when we are seeing a number of discretionary EWs before. And that's a very specific example. It's a little bit more broad within the plan, but that's kind of the idea of growing that sharing of data and utilizing that data for our own purposes to inform the program. So this is the kind of the meat, I suppose, the biggest piece of information that most people are probably interested to see come out of the data management plan revision is the idea of defining new metrics to help us define and better, from the EQB's perspective, better be able to analyze the effectiveness of the program and how the program is being implemented and what the program is actually achieving. So, the metrics that were defined and the information from those metrics ideally would have been incorporated to the way that we already collect our information, and that's through the EQB monitor submittal service that has required questions that you have to answer before you publish. But that wasn't very, the time constriction of actually implementing that wasn't very realistic. We did want to actually start to incorporate, to collect this information sooner rather than later. So we will be implementing some surveys to supplement the information that we gather from monitor submittals. So the surveys are going to be split into two different surveys. There'll be one survey, and they're only for EAW publications. That's where we're going to start, because that's kind of the majority of the submittals that we see anyways. We think that'll give us the most information to start. So they will be focused only on EAWs for now. And the first survey will go out to the RGU contact that is listed when an EAW notice of availability is published. So the first official publication for a project requiring EAW with the EQB. So we'll get that information submitted to us, and we'll pull that contact for the RGU, and a survey will be submitted to them with some questions. And that first survey kind of has two topic ideas to cover and gain more information about. The first topic, or the first idea of information gathering, is focused mainly on the time spent preparing an EAW, better understanding, you know, the interactions between project proposers and RGUs prior to publication of an EAW. So that information will help supplement the information that we already collect about time spent in environment review. However, that information that we are already collecting is more so guided to understand, you know, compliance with rule mandated timelines. And so from that information that we collect, we don't see a whole lot of variability, as those are really prescribed by rule, and most people tend to follow the rule. I mean, the most variation that we see is kind of the more controversial projects that might receive a lot of comments during a public comment period. And so there's typically either some sort of agreement between a project proposer and an RGU to extend that timeline, or insufficient information within rule will be applied to that project, giving, you know, additional time to address comments and things of that nature. So by asking additional questions about information and time spent prior to publication, we'll have a better idea of the process as a whole, be able to understand, you know, the time and the interactions spent across the entire process, rather than sort of just the rule mandated timelines. And so the questions, you know, should lead to the EQB really having a better understanding of when RGUs and project proposers are determining the need for an EAW, and then understanding, you know, when first data submittals or draft EAWs are actually being submitted to RGUs, and then also expanding and understanding the amount of sort of incomplete determinations of submittals, and that back and forth between RGUs and project proposers prior to determining that the EAW is actually complete. And so the survey really should provide information for the EQB to better understand, you know, the type of interaction that RGUs are having with project proposers prior to determining that the EAW is complete and prior to any publication. But also, given the questions in there, it'll also provide some information to determine, you know, in any interaction that is happening between a project proposer and an RGU before an actual data submittal or a draft EAW is being submitted to an RGU, to see if that RGU is actually given an opportunity to inform a project proposer about potential things they want to see or have evaluated within the EAW, to kind of see that part of the process is actually happening or being given an opportunity to happen. So from that, that's kind of the first topic of this first survey, and then it goes into a different second topic. And so those questions within that first survey are meant to better inform about any engagement that is happening prior to publication. So currently, the only information that we really truly collect about engagement is whether or not a public meeting was held during a public comment period, and the number of comment letters that were received during a public comment period. So that is important information, but it really doesn't shine a light at all on what might be happening prior to publication. So by asking simple questions of whether or not, you know, project information is being shared with the public before a EAW is being published, will just help shine a light for the EQB on how the program is really being implemented, and if those early engagement efforts are actually happening. The questions then try to build on that and understanding the impact that engagement is having on the process, and if that's identifying, you know, routes to evaluate within your EAW or ideas to incorporate within your project design and things of that nature. So that's kind of the first survey goal is both time and engagement. And then the second survey will come at the time that an EIS needs decision is published. So the first survey is likely the first contact with the EQB for an EAW, and the second survey as long as an EIS is not ordered, will be the last contact with the EQB for that EAW project. And it'll go back to the same RGU contact as before. And this, the second survey is really meant to gain more information on the impact that environmental review had on that project. Some things along the lines of understanding, you know, did a public comment period result in project changes, information being included in a record of decision, or other things of that nature that can show the impact of the actual process. And then it also grows to add a little bit to the information that we already collect, indicating whether or not the EAW process or the environment process provided usable information, and trying to better understand if that process is truly identifying information that is useful for decision makers, and is the EAW process actually identifying specific measures that should be incorporated into a permit, and if so, what permit? And so by asking those questions, we're seeing a better interaction and a better understanding of how environmental review is informing decision makers and permitting process. And also by asking that question, I think it has the opportunity to have a bit of a twofold sort of improvement of, now that you've been asked to identify, you know, the type of mitigation or something that's going to be need to be included in a permit, you know, by having to supply that information, does it hopefully increase the likelihood that that information will then stay with the project instead of just being potentially identified in the EAW and then lost in the proceeds. Excuse me. And so, you know, the survey again, in a whole, will really help EQB understand how the program is being implemented and then also what the program is achieving. So the survey questions as a whole are really intended to be pretty simple to respond to. Combined, the two surveys are about 15 questions only, and there's responses are pretty, there's options to choose from to make it a little bit easier. So as far as time to fill out the survey, I am anticipating 10 minutes. Catherine likes to say 5 minutes. So I really don't see it as a large time commitment to complete, but the information that we get should be very impactful for EQB's understanding. Now, we do understand, you know, when this is first implemented, that, you know, RGUs have not been asked to collect this information before, so there may be a little bit of helping and offering that guidance as this is rolled out, and helping them understand what kind of information we're looking for and why we're looking for the information. We have shared a little bit with some LGU representatives, both the tech reps and some more local level representatives from the counties, and we've also shared with the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce the survey questions and kind of the idea of why we're collecting this information and what it will lead to. So the goal was probably to launch this to tie with kind of the fiscal year. So July 1 was our target date, but that was just kind of a choice to start with this implementation. So we probably still targeting that with, you know, the idea that if we hit that, great, if we don't, the survey questions are still a little bit in draft form sharing up there. So we do have a plan of, you know, sharing within our own publications, the Monitor publication and our EQB newsletter about our intent to launch the survey so that RGUs are aware of it before it just shows up in their email. And so they have that idea of a survey actually coming. And so hopefully they'll have that information more readily available to them once we actually do implement this. And then the other part of the aspect of the plan that I wanted to touch on in a little bit more detail goes into the idea of increasing the transparency of the data that we collect within environmental review. So EQB staff is intending to launch a simple data website that will house past performance reports. It will provide a little bit of a consolidation of our, you know, access to the active project map that we had in our environmental project database. But then it'll also launch, kind of the bigger thing is our public dashboard, which will provide sort of a summarization of the data that we collect in a bit more user-friendly way. It gives them, you know, the user a little bit of a ability to play with and filter the data to represent, you know, by program review process, project type, and year, and it spits out a couple of different statistics for you to see. So that'll I do have a snapshot to share of that. I'll share that after. Well, that'll be rolled out soon. It's still a little bit draft stage, so it's not quite ready to be out yet, but it's getting close. And then we do have a couple projects that our IDEC student worker is working on, who you met earlier, Elizabeth. One of those being the consolidation of our historic data. And so, unfortunately, the idea of annually summarizing our information has kind of continued to live in that separated annual idea. It doesn't really have a great way of evaluating trends for staff purposes, or just simple information requests about what's happened in the past year is really disjointed and unfortunate. So kind of just consolidating that information into sort of a master file makes life a lot easier for a lot of different people. But then it also provides opportunities for us to, you know, evaluate, potentially represent that information in new ways. So that's another exciting opportunity to supplement possibly the public dashboard. And then the last one is what we're calling a technical assistance library and the development of that. So EQB, when responding to technical assistance, EQB staff are responding to technical assistance, you know, there's a desire to be as consistent and possible as possible when making, you know, rule interpretations or talking about implementation of the program. And that's kind of hard to do, given it's just never been categorized in a happy way to make sure that we can continue to track that. So by developing sort of a library and categorizing things by topics and storing our responses to those things will really make that simpler for staff moving forward, provide that level of consistency to make sure that, you know, we don't have potential, you know, different interpretations from different staff and things of that nature. But I'll also, by doing that, improve staff's ability to kind of track the types and topics of comments or things that we're typically providing to users and help, you know, identify potential guidance updates and things of that nature. And then lastly, the public dashboard. So exciting. It's just a snapshot. I was told it's okay to share this, even though it's still a bit draft stage. But as you can see here, it kind of summarizes a couple pieces of information and statistics about the program. And you can filter it through different environmental review processes. So if you wanted to just see EAWs, for instance, you could change that. Statistics would change based on that choice. Or we did group them into mandatory categories into different project types. Given that I don't know that the public is that familiar with each mandatory category, so it just kind of simplified that idea a little bit. And then by the year, you can also filter it. And then there is some functionality here between the map and some other statistics, where if you wanted to see or get greater information about a specific project, it actually has some functionality where it will link to the project database. You can download the documents from there and gain and grab that information if you're looking for more project specific information. That's all I got. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them. Otherwise, you can put some contact information. I can chat data about environment review anytime. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesse. Questions or comments from ARIS members? Mr. Dobenberger.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Jesse, thank you for your presentation and all your work on this so far. You were talking about the surveys, and I like the information that you're planning to gather from the surveys. Did I understand you hope to launch that soon, and then it's kind of in real time as projects come up, right?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking about that, and then thinking about our last topic, our previous discussion on surveys and you know, getting more input. I'm just wondering about the timing of that. And, you know, is it something where what you're seeking, could that be part of more focused data that we're collecting with next year's CI process? Or do we do something completely different with the CI process surveys, such that it's clear to folks what we're, you know, gathering with these with EAWs, EISs, and engagement that they're doing as part of that versus the other continuous improvement sort of input. So your thoughts or Executive Director?
Chair, Commissioner Donner, I think that's a great question. I think, you know, the intent is to focus these questions on the RGU's perspective. And so these will be going out as they are submitting notices. So this will come right as they're working within their project. So they should be pretty comfortable with this information, be able to access that pretty quickly. I don't know that it's not going to go to the project proposer or the public. It's going to go, it is guided to kind of gain that information from the RGU's perspective. So I think the idea was really to incorporate that into the monitor submittal. So it would have been a required step. But that just wasn't a realistic lift for us to complete. So hopefully incorporating that information to the survey will still give us the information about the program and how it's being implemented and be impactful in that way. And so I think that there is it's not the same as the CI process. It's more guided towards a true RGU understanding of what they're doing with the program.
Did you have something?
Oh, yeah, I could just add. I mean, it really is. It's project specific data. And I think one of the things people have, you know, we've heard things like, well, how long does environmental really take? We don't know. You don't collect the data. This is like our attempt to step into collecting some of that data so that we can aggregate it for the program and see if there's, see what that tells us. So
thank you.
Thanks, Jesse. I also think this is really useful and I think it'd be welcomed by people who are working in environmental review in the agencies and elsewhere. And I like this idea of a public facing dashboard where people can filter and look at it. I am thinking in my mind about questions that we get regularly that the legislature has been asking about how long it takes to do different steps of the regulatory process, and appreciate that people will be able to get that data at least going forward. For how long it can take as we have to forecast how we're going to coordinate and realistic timelines and where people can plug into this. My one question is, and I don't know that this is answerable at this moment, but thinking about all the work that happens prior to the date that an application is submitted, because there's a lot of back and forth that happens between project proposers and the RGU, whether that's a state entity or a local unit of government, to help set up that application for smooth process. And we know, and we hear this from people who are on the other end of this, that it is very much appreciated that that type of assistance and iterative back and forth that occurs prior to the application coming in for the EAW. Is there any way to account for that? In my mind, people are like, well, it takes so long. We started talking to you 2 years ago. Well, the application came in 20 months ago, or let's just say 20 months after we started talking to you, because there was a lot of project definition that needed to happen before they could actually submit something that could be considered.
Sure. I'm chairing the Commissioner Keswick. Yeah, the survey does sort of have like a hard timeline identification of when an EAW is determined as being needed. And then there are other questions that try to incorporate that exact idea of, you know, were there back and forth actually before that happened, and sort of building that information of because in my experience at the at local level, sometimes that happens and sometimes
right. It does not.
So trying to get that understanding and being able to show that program wide for sure and understanding how that is consistently happening. But yes, I think the questions within the survey do kind of capture that idea of what sort of back and forth and information was provided to help actually put together the end.
Yeah, and I think that's great. And even if we could, as you design this or think about how to improve this along the way, even capture like approximately how many conversations happened prior to submittal or how many months of conversation occurred, because that gets at what people will criticize in terms of it takes a very long time to move through these processes, and a lot of that work isn't officially counted.
Other questions or thoughts?
Can I add something just briefly, Madam Chair?
Yes.
I just, you know, I think we all are aware that surveys are a good tool, but they're not always a tool where you get 100% compliance. And we, you know, one of the things that we'll have to be reviewing and adapting to is, you know, we're trying to make these questions as simple as possible so that it really is just click, click, click. Like, when did you start? Click, click. As always, with everything environmental review, defining the little pieces is a little bit complicated. So we're hoping and we're talking to folks about like encouraging people and explaining why we want to do this so that hopefully we will get good response rate. But that will, of course, be something that we will have to watch and adapt to and see how it goes. So, and it is not going to be mandatory. It's going to be something that sends people when they send their notice. And we're just going to hope that they find enough value in the big picture information. They will contribute to it.
So I think, Director Neusler, that gets to my point here, which is, you know, I think there could be real value in this. I also recognize that we often have a conversation about the limited capacity of RGUs and that this, at the same time now, we're asking them to do something additional. And so I think it's really important for us to think really strategically about what we're asking for and what can be asked through a simple, straightforward question that can be clicked through that is ultimately going to be helpful. Right. And I mean, this is not the same thing, but I think of, you know, to what degree of precision is data useful, right? And so sometimes at DNR, right, we're getting into like, let's measure everything down to the 10th of an acre. That may not be important. What we're asking ourselves is, are we adding, you know, acreage of public land or are we not? We don't need to, you know, have real precision around that. And so to me, there's that same question here about what precision do we need to really evaluate and get some sense of the questions we're trying to understand around effectiveness versus the time it's going to take. And I think that's particularly important given that we're talking about project specific environmental review. And the reality is, I mean, that question of how long does environmental review take? It depends, right? And I mean, we know that. And so at times being able to give some parameter is really useful. And if you are an outlier project, that timeline is meaningless to you. And so just really thinking about what we're asking people to do, the time it's going to take to do that, and knowing that if they're taking time to do that, they're maybe not having a conversation with the project proposer. And the flip side is, how are we really going to be able to aggregate and use data in a way that is meaningful and not sort of getting pointed at if somebody's the outlier? It's not helpful. So I think this can be a really powerful tool. I just also really encourage us to think about what is it that we really need to know in an aggregate sense, and let's focus on that, and let's focus on the right level of precision so that we're not asking people things that ultimately aren't really useful to us or to the RGUs and understanding the program because we're not getting what we thought we might get out of it.
Yeah, Chair Stroman, I think we've tried to do that. And to Commissioner Kessler's point, we may not say how many conversations.
Right.
It might be yes or no, because right now, like, that's helpful. And it's one click instead of going, oh, gosh, now I got to see how many things were on my calendar and how many meetings right. did I have. So, yes, we are keeping that in mind. And I think certainly your point about, you know, what's needed in terms of individualized versus aggregate data is well taken as well.
All right, one last call for questions and or comments on this item. All right, I'm not seeing any, Jesse. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. So with that, we are actually, as Director Neusler noted at the beginning, we're going to take a 5-minute break. So it's we're going to call it 2:15. We'll come back at about 2:20. And share agenda. Stand up and stretch.
Yes, stand up.
The stand up and stretch. I will.
Yeah. No.
You said you were doing outreach.
All right. Back in order, the Environmental Review Implementation Subcommittee here. And it was nice to have a break, Director.
You should.
Thank you.
All right.
For that, but we're going to get back to work here. We have Kayla here to update us on the work around mandatory categories report. So, Kayla, thank you for being here.
Thank you, Chair, and good afternoon, everybody. Again, my name is Kayla Walsh, and I am part of our environmental review team here at EPB. And last month, I presented a little bit of the background information on sort of what the mandatory category report is and the process that we're using to draft it. And so today I am bringing another brief update on how that process is moving along to write it. And my goal today is really to share and to cover the report goal and methodology that we're using to write it. And I'll touch on how we're integrating this report with the continuous improvement process that the board enacted last year. And then lastly, I will share how we're approaching our recommendations and how we're deciding what recommendations are in scope versus out of scope as we're drafting. So like I mentioned in our last meeting, this iteration of the report, the 2024 report, can be distilled into two different goals. So first, we do need to ensure that we are fulfilling the legislative intent. And the legislative charge says that we need to identify the historical purpose of each category, and we also need to list whether or not a permit is required for projects under that category. And that could be a state, local, or any type of permit or approval. And then we also need to list whether we have any recommendations for a category. And those recommendations could be to modify the category, remain unchanged, or delete the category. And that provides us with a good baseline for what's required in the legislation. But we really want the report to be useful. We don't want it to sit on a shelf. We want it to be referenced. So that's where this part two of our goal comes in making our recommendations. We are really thinking about how can we improve the mandatory categories to create a better program. So we're providing a state of the state on the mandatory categories and discussing how the categories are really working. So are they serving us? Are they effective? And we'll get back to that effective word in a minute. But first, I wanted to show the full legislative charge. I know it's a lot of words on the screen, but this is the statute that we're referencing. And this is found in 116D. And it directs EQB to submit this report to the legislature every 3 years with the help of the Department of Natural Resources, Department of Transportation, and the Pollution Control Agency. And so it directs us to, again, list the historical purpose, the permits, and whether projects that would fall into that category would be subject to any other approvals. And with the help of our technical representatives, we have been able to do a lot more of this analysis part this year of the different categories. So part three, it says an analysis and recommendations. And so we're taking a lot of care to fully analyze how the categories are being used and if we could improve them to be more effective. And when we think about the effectiveness of a category, my mind immediately jumps again to our CI process that we brought up a lot today. And during that process, the board identified those 9 criteria for an effective program, but not all 9 of those criteria really fit with mandatory category changes. So I think it's fair to call out these 3 items for an effective program. So that would be scientific integrity, user friendliness, and consistency. And so for scientific integrity, we can ask ourselves, is the threshold of this mandatory category based in the latest science and the latest information that is available to us? And then for user friendliness, we could ask, was this category written in a way that is easy to read, interpret, and implement? Or do we often get a lot of phone calls with questions about this? And then lastly, but in a very similar vein, does the category get applied consistently? So are the terms and definitions that are used in that mandatory category, are they aligned with the permit definitions in the program for projects in that mandatory category, so there's no confusion across different programs? And then since we did a lot of public engagement for both the CI process and this mandatory category writing process, I wanted to touch on the differences between the two really quickly. So if you remember back to when we were doing the or designing the continuous improvement process in that solicitation phase, we did receive a lot of comments. About 32 of those comments we decided at the time were so specific to mandatory categories that we tabled them and siphoned them into being reviewed in this report. So we're doing that now. But that continuous improvement process was really looking at program level project ideas, and the feedback for mandatory categories is much more granular and specific to certain word changes or updates to thresholds and categories. So that's a bit of a lower level or a more granular change than evaluating a program or a project change through CI. So that brings me to our methodology for how we're writing the mandatory category report. So last month, I spoke a lot about our engagement update. I shared our engagement memo through our public engagement, but we're analyzing a lot more than solely public engagement. So we asked all of our tech reps to fill out a form telling EQB about any inconsistencies or issues that they run into with interpreting mandatory categories. And so we received a lot of really good information from state agencies, tech reps through those forms, and we've had follow-on conversations about that. And then we also promoted our survey and engagement HQ to several LGU, local government unit organizations like the League of Minnesota Cities and the Chamber of Commerce and the Association of Minnesota Counties. And so we've looked at what petitions say as well and what technical assistance questions EQB has received in the past 3 years to see if there are any common or reoccurring questions that we get per mandatory category. And then I've also been reading our previous sonars, our statements for need and reasonableness to sketch out if we have any, you know, brief narratives for the history of each category. So I've incorporated, lastly, any issues identified from the 2021 version of the report that might still apply today. And so then we've taken all that information and we're meeting regularly with our co-authoring agencies, the tech reps from our partner agencies, and we're meeting about every other week to review those ideas and discuss how the report will be formatted and what types of changes might apply to each category. So again, whether that category would need to be modified to be more effective or remain unchanged. And so our co-authors have done a really great job helping us to go through all of that information and all of those ideas that we've received and really build upon some of those ideas that fit with what they're seeing as well. And in some cases, they've helped explain, you know, why that idea might be out of scope or better handled in a permitting procedure or elsewhere. And so we will continue meeting with our co-authors so we can continue to get into some of the more specific category recommendations. In the last report in 2021, those were called issues identified, if you look back. But this time around, we're calling them recommendations so that it aligns with the legislative charge that says and analyze and recommend. So if there is an opportunity to update a category and make a recommendation to update a category, there are times when we might be able to update our guidance to provide better guidance on that category, and I might do the trick, but we can only update our guidance to clarify certain things. There are, you know, more often situations where we would need a rule change to help us clarify a definition or a term. So those would be pretty straightforward rule changes to update a reference or a term that might already be defined elsewhere. But we could also be recommending a longer rulemaking, like a threshold change. So that would be a really engaged process, and it would mean you know, creating a rulemaking process to further scope and design that rule. Oh, and I skipped over this, but I do think that the bottom square there is a different color because we do think it's important to make the recommendations actionable, but the report isn't designed to help us to prioritize the recommendations. It's really just laying out a menu of options, and then we can look at that and prioritize it in our work planning. So the way that the report is framing up so far, it's looking like we'll have a detailed analysis or a discussion for each mandatory category, and that'll provide context that will layer up to a recommendation. And that discussion will offer some more specific options, like you could explain why a threshold might be updated to reflect the latest permit information or the latest science, but that would layer up into that recommendation that would most likely read something like this: consider evaluating a category to update its thresholds based on the discussion. And so we want to convey, you know, that might sound a little bit more vague, but we want to convey that that would take a rulemaking, and we understand that rulemaking is not a short process, it's not easy, and we want to make sure that we are recognizing that if we were to undertake a rulemaking process, it would require a lot more conversations and discussions and perspective building moving forward. So the recommendations themselves on the screen might seem pretty vague, but the discussion will provide more detail in the report. And so then as we are meeting with our writing team, we're always talking about what is in scope and out of scope. And I think high level, we all agree that the mandatory category report should include what projects get reviewed, at what sizes, and when. And so that includes anything that falls under these two rules, 4410, 4300, and 4400. So those are the EAW and EIS mandatory category rules. And then we heard from a lot of people, including RGUs, that there are a few projects that consistently are not being reviewed, but maybe that project type should get reviewed. And so there are a couple possibly new additions to the mandatory categories that are being discussed. And so we could be adding some more context around those. Any definitions that we would need to be updated or need to be written, we could recommend that could happen in 4410.0200, which is the definition section of the mandatory categories. And then when we're thinking about determining when a project is reviewed, that could include expiration dates on EAWs and EISs. So the thing that expirations is really trying to get at is this idea that a project could have been reviewed decades ago and still be operating, but maybe our scientific understanding of the potential effects of that project have evolved, and it could benefit from being re-reviewed in a way, and so, or reviewed if it had never been reviewed in the first place. So we're hearing that it can also be really unclear to know at what point a project might be considered changed enough to have to redo or update their EAW. And so that's why expirations is on our list here. And then something that is pretty clearly out of scope would be any changes that could impact the program very broadly. So these broader topics would be transferred to maybe the continuous improvement process because they are that program level, that higher level. And an example of that would be considering health impacts assessments and environmental review. And we received a lot of comments about HIAs, and people feel very strongly that they could be included whenever an environmental impact statement is done. And I think that's something we could discuss as an idea during the continuous improvement process, but does not necessarily apply to this report. So I don't think that we have any big differences from last month with the timeline that we shared. EQB is continuing to meet regularly, like I said, with our co-authors, and we're diving into some of the specific recommendations now in different mandatory categories. So we're again, relying on our co-authors' professional judgment to help us to formulate some of those recommendations. And then we will present a full draft to ARIS in September. We want to do some final edits and then send out a draft for the board then to review in October. And hopefully the report should be pretty much where we all want it by the November board meeting, so we can vote on it, and then it will be due, vote to approve it, and then it'll be due in December 1st. So we are rolling right along with our drafting and involving our experts from different agencies as, you know, as it's needed. And I really look forward to sharing more information, hopefully in the next couple months, and some actual draft language. So thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Questions or comments from ARIS members? Take ARIS first and then other EQB board members. Member Nelson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A question for Kayla. I understand this goes to the legislature. Correct. But in your recommendations, some of those may be just rule changes. Some of them may be suggested legislation changes. Rule changes, are those things that the board could consider themselves? And then legislative ones, do you just kind of leave it at the legislature, or does the administration sort of consider sort of those things in their sort of legislative agenda at some point?
Kayla, do you want to answer?
I can take a stab at that. Thank you for the question, Board Member Nelson. Thank you, Chair. So as the formal audience for the report is the legislature, and I do think that it has also been a report that's been referenced a lot by responsible governmental units and other state agencies and local governmental units too. And so the recommendations that are in the report are identifying information that could improve the usability of those mandatory categories for everyone who interacts with environmental review. But the recommendations are mostly going to be rulemaking, which EQB does have the authority to do rulemaking for our rules for 4410 for environmental review. And then any legislative conversation would take place at the legislature, so I don't have any. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to add, I mean, just because there is a standard timing of a legislative report does not preclude the EQB from updating or promulgating rules that it has the authority to do, nor would it necessarily preclude the administration from making a legislative proposal. It's sort of a notice that these are recommendations that, you know, maybe acted on some timetable, and the legislature can act accordingly as it wishes. The administration can act accordingly as it wishes, as long as it's within authorities. Agencies, it's not uncommon for agencies to have to produce any number of reports to the legislature, some of them with recommendations, some of them just an update. Other questions or comments? It's a good one. All right. Any questions or comments from EQB board members who are not part of ARIS? Not to put anyone on the spot, but just want to get that opportunity. Kayla, it looks like you did a very thorough job in your presentation, so thank you for that. It was really helpful. I mean, obviously, this is really important work, and so appreciate the opportunity to get into it. Okay, well, we are
I'll move to the next item on our agenda, which is the public comment section of our agenda. So for members of the public who may be here to share a comment with the Environmental Review Implementation Subcommittee, I just ask you to raise your hands in Teams if you have a comment. And as a reminder, we have the comment guidelines on the screen as well. We will pause for a moment or two to see if anyone wants to raise their hand. Okay, well, it does not look like we have anyone. So I want to thank the members of the Environmental Review Implementation Subcommittee, and as well as our board members. Really appreciate you spending the time on a committee that you are not on to participate in our meeting and discussion. So with that, we are at the end of the agenda, and I would ask for a motion to adjourn.
I can make that motion.
Okay. All right. Motion made by Commissioner Kessler, seconded by Commissioner Dobenberger. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, please say nay. All right. Not surprisingly, there's no opposition to the motion adjourned, so motion carries and we are adjourned.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.